Well, I want to start off with a familiar word from Jesus. So that's the way to start, right? Because that's a Sunday school thing to do. What therefore God hath joined together, let not man put asunder. So what was he referring to? Marriage, all right. And later on, Paul uses in Ephesians a marriage as a metaphor for something else. What was that?
Christ and the church.
The church, thank you very much. So I'm going to stretch it maybe just a little bit farther, and I'm going to talk about three things that I think that God has joined together, but we have tended to put asunder today in the church. And when I say the church, I'll be slightly autobiographical here. You'll hear in a minute, I'll use terms like evangelical and so forth. That's kind of my background. I'm at Wheaton College. If you know about Wheaton College, you know it's Protestant evangelical. I became a Christian in my early 20s in actually the charismatic movement. So that's kind of my primary audience for the book out of which, and I brought a copy of the book up, there it is, for this book, which this talk is based on. What this is, at least in part, is this evangelical figuring out some things that, for example, Catholics have known for a long time. So you can sort of pat me on the head afterwards and say, that's really nice that you finally figured that out. I appreciate that. But the three things that I think that we tend to pull apart today, and evangelicals in particular, but I think it's larger in the society and larger in the church. I'll enumerate them here. Faith and reason, okay? Love and logic, and the spiritual and the material. And so, like a good Protestant preacher, I'll give you 3 points to this. Hopefully it won't be too much of a sermon, but it does have 3 points. So faith and reason. I think we do have a tendency, or a couple tendencies, either to veer into obscurantist fideism, just sort of faith alone, check your brains at the door. That's on one end. And then at the other end is this sort of argumentative hyper-intellectualism, which is more interested in arguments and systems than perhaps the Lord himself, although I would not say that myself. Then logic and love, focusing either again on self-righteous argumentation or on fuzzy-headed sentimentalism. And then finally, the spiritual and the material, courting either super spirituality, I'll define these terms, and cultural irrelevance, or materialism and cultural captivity. So those are the three I'm going to do. And I actually misspoke about faith and reason. Fideism is at the one end. The other, I would say, is sometimes an intellectual substitute for the faith. All right. But we'll get into those as we move forward. I wanted to say a word about this book project. I got into it about 7 years ago. To my editor's dismay, it took me 6 years to write the thing. But the reason I got into it, and I didn't really know why at the time, was a kind of a lack that I felt in my own church experience and church background. I love the evangelical movement for its clear-eyed presentation of the gospel. I became a Christian through the movement. But when I went to it to find out how to live well in God and in the world in particular, in that world of marriages and workplaces and landscapes and cities and novels and movies and politics, I often didn't find that there was any there. Like James Davison Hunter, like Mark Knoll, I often find that evangelicals are not present at the table where people are studying to understand these things. And I wanted to know what it would be like to embrace the world a little bit more from a standpoint of faith. So in short, evangelical Protestantism has not given me a really coherent theology of living well in the world, or a vision of living well in the world. It does really well, I think, in a sort of narrow spiritual band, but and some both public and private issues of morality. But other than that, I found it difficult to get a more holistic approach to life in the world. Now, evangelical Protestants inherited a certain distrust of more culturally rich forms of the faith from the radical streams of the Reformation. And in the frontier revivalism of 19th century America, this distrust intensified into something, I think, of a mania. In the book, I talk about the mother of the holiness and therefore grandmother of the Pentecostal and charismatic movements, a little-known Methodist laywoman, unless you're in these movements, Phoebe Palmer, who preached and spoke on a shorter way to God. In the 19th century, American evangelicals were all about anything that could shorten that way to God. And a lot of what that involved was stripping away the inherited traditions of, essentially, of the church. And in the book, I treat this whole question of evangelical anti-traditionalism in much more detail than I can here. But essentially, I use this basic term, immediatism. You probably haven't heard it used in this way. I'm coining this way of using it. But it seemed to me to speak to this shorter way and this lack of mediation between the believer and God. And I'll explain that a little bit. Evangelicals have long believed that the only thing that really matters to us as Christians in the end is that each of us can go directly and individually and without any mediation from human leaders or material sacraments or rituals to the throne of God. Now, this takes two forms, I think. First, we can experience Him directly in the worship that we engage in, no matter what the forms of that worship are, and those are very fluid and plastic, as long as they're basically very accessible, very popular, very plain, that people can immediately come to God through that worship. And second, evangelicals believe we can understand God directly through reading the Bible, which communicates revelation to us clearly, without complication, or the need for traditional helps, like crusty old theologians and books. In light of these two moves, then all the traditions handed down to us are essentially unnecessary. We don't need liturgies, we don't need confessional statements of doctrine, church polities and disciplines that are complicated and worked out in advance. We don't need those things to worship and be before God well. And we don't need, again, to read past theologians to interpret and understand the truths that God communicates to us in Scripture. So, in light of immediatism, and there's more in the book, but I'm summarizing a lot of stuff today, we take it that God is simply not interested in mediating structures inside the church. And following that logic, He's even less interested in the ordinary world, again, of workplaces and cities and literature and politics and science. In the narrow and, again, I use the term super-spiritual or spiritualizing interpretation of the immediatist, Word and world become, I'm afraid, separated. So, rhetorical question here. I think you'll know what my answer is if you've seen the title of the book or of the talk. Is there any time in history when the church kept together what we have now sundered? Faith and reason, love and logic, the spiritual and the material. I believe that the answer is so obvious that if at least those in my tribe didn't have this inherent blind spot, we would immediately see it. It's this millennium of church history between 500 and 1500. For many evangelicals, God left the church after Constantine and doesn't come back until Luther, or maybe Wesley, or maybe my pastor, depending on who you are. But during that time, what I find is a Christian culture that is certainly not flawless, but is in general deeply committed to the understandings of the Bible, and who wield the best of the classical tradition too, by the way, and that's something that Lewis will share, as we'll see. And they concern themselves both with the ways that our life in Christ is mediated through human structures within our worship, and also with every aspect of life in the world. I'm going to get serious dry mouth here. If someone can bring me a glass of water, somewhere. Thank you so much. I appreciate it. Now, again, this is no golden age. I don't think anyone would defend everything that goes on within this period. These are human beings. They got some things wrong, even as they got some things very right. But it's an age for me that takes such strikingly earthy, practical, and at the same time deeply spiritual approaches to being human in a God-made world that I think we cannot help but learn from it if we're only willing to look. All right. So now, I promised a few words about how I came to write the book, and that might help put this whole thing in focus. As I started to read C.S. Lewis's nonfiction as an adult, I had read the Narnia series, I'd read the Space Trilogy, loved that when I was a teenager. But as I started to read his nonfiction, I began to see a coherent theology and spirituality of ordinary life that retains crucial understandings of grace and wonder, but also revels in the material world for what it is, and in human culture. So I would say revels in the natural world for what it is, but also human culture, the built world, the made world of human beings. And for the sub-salvific, but nonetheless godly and sacramental qualities it can have. We'll come back to the term sacramental. That became important to me as I was researching the book. So in Lewis, I saw this other dimension of faith that engages the world and human nature and ordinary morality in what I found to be a deeper and more practical and more livable way than I was finding in my own evangelical tradition. And so I asked the question, where did he get all that? Now, if you know a little bit about Lewis, you know that there is not a single source for almost anything that he got. He was a bit of an intellectual magpie. He picked things up all over the place. But I think it's fair to say that in this case, he got this kind of holistic approach from a deep reading in the Christian tradition, in both the early and the medieval, but I think particularly the medieval tradition, because there's something particular about that tradition that holds these things together, as I'll argue. He's a professional medievalist. Many evangelicals who read him don't remember that or don't want to understand that or think it's kind of odd that anybody who was a medievalist could actually have this kind of wisdom. Because again, remember, God left the church of Constantine and Luther. His medievalism was much more than professional. I argue in the book that he was an intuitive medievalist. And I mean by that he really absorbed a medieval understanding as a way of seeing. He characterizes himself in his Cambridge address, De Descriptione Temporum, where he's being installed as the chair of medieval and Renaissance studies at Cambridge in 1954. He says, I'm a dinosaur. I'm a relic. I'm somebody who actually is kind of from the past, like somebody born out of time. That's how immersed he is in both the medieval and the early Christian past. In the engaging introduction to his, okay, I'm going to do a little survey here. Because first of all, how many folks are kind of like Lewis or read him? All right, yep, good. All right, so now I know why you showed up. It had nothing to do with me. Anyone own his book, English Literature in the 16th Century? Yay! Okay, you've read it, right? The whole thing?
No,
me neither. Okay. But in the introduction to that book, he kind of sets up the, because it's like this, right? He sets up the kind of the medieval mindset as a door opener for talking about the 16th century. And here's what he said. I'm not going to directly quote at this point, but basically he notes that medievals speak in one breath of the great universals, and in the next of earthy particulars with no sense of incongruity. The worlds of metaphysics and physics, high morality and everyday work, interweave and interpenetrate seamlessly and again sacramentally. They're not divided into this sacred world of church and theology on the one hand and a secular world of everyday life. So as I studied both Lewis and the medieval authors, looking especially at this habit of interweaving the spiritual and the material, again, a trait I've learned to call sacramentality, I discovered that it rests on a very important foundation. That is a full and rich appreciation for the amazing fact of the incarnation. All right? In that truly stunning central event of the Christian story, which I would say many modern Protestants skip over so they can get to the cross and they can get to the atonement, get to the resurrection. The greatest universal of them all, God himself, comes down into the particular, concrete, material, cultural space of first century Palestine in the form of a baby born in a cold, dark, presumably, I say it's cold because it happened at Christmas time, right? Presumably also dirty stable. Who then lived out the very material, emotional, and moral life that we too share. If we take the incarnation seriously, as the medievals and also Lewis most certainly did, I think we can never again see people or land or culture as spiritually irrelevant or beside the point of our faith. And we need to then ask, how do we live in this world that our God also deigned to come and live in? So my argument in the book is that when we follow Lewis to his sources, not only, but importantly also Plato and Aristotle, but also Boethius, Francis of Assisi, Thomas of Aquinas, Lady Julian of Norwich, and also the Canterbury Tales, Dante's Divine Comedy, every one of them is soaked in this incarnational and holistic worldview. And then we can gain a new sense of how to live as fully human beings, embracing our material and cultural world as the active arena of God's concern and God's work. And here's where my work as a sort of faith and work, faith and vocation guy is going to come out. I think then we can come to see that working for IBM, or bringing the neighbor kids to a ball game, or reading a novel, or painting a painting, or serving on the PTA, or researching microbes in the lab, and we can go on and on and on. In short, everything we do in our ordinary Monday to Saturday lives is a single sacramental unit in which faith and reason, love and logic, and material and spiritual interpenetrate and uphold each other. So now we're going to jump in. I'll do a little bit longer bit on faith and reason, and then we're going to go briefly through love and logic and spiritual and material after I have some water. Now, so starting faith and reason. One of these things, one of these pairs of once united things that I think is often being torn apart in our church cultures today. Time doesn't allow me to dwell on Lewis's typically ancient and medieval pursuit of philosophy as a way of life and not just a subject, or to try to get into the weeds of his deep appreciation for Thomas Aquinas and the medieval scholastic philosophers. Although many of the things that we might think he gets from Aquinas, he actually gets from Aristotle, but be that as it may. For now, let's just take it as read that this brilliant ex-atheist found a way to reconcile faith and reason and to hold them together in his life and work. And now we'll move directly to some of his medieval sources on this. Let's start with the medieval synthesis of the scholastic theologians of the 12th and 13th centuries. Anselm, Abelard, Aquinas, I don't know why all their names start with A, but they do. And these thinkers brought together faith and reason in a kind of a breathtaking dance. Their efforts and the understanding that came from them birthed such cultural institutions. You may have heard of these, the university, the hospital, the research laboratory even, the foundations are all laid in that period. These thinkers worked, by the way, Aquinas' mentor, Albertus Magnus, is something of an empiricist before his time. He's running around asking people questions, tradesmen, questions about how things work. He has really a scientific imagination and curiosity. So these thinkers worked in a tradition that valued reason highly. This is something that's really crucial. We may have caricatures often rooted in Monty Python of a kind of medieval stupidity, right? These are people who went around burning witches and whacking themselves on the head with boards, right? One of the caricatures is that they believed in a flat earth. We can go into where that myth came from, but it's actually not true. Everybody from the classical period on who had any kind of decent education knew that the earth was a sphere and actually probably knew the approximate circumference. So believe me when I say, and yes, I know there's a difference here between literate and illiterate, but the oral tradition is also very powerful, that the medieval tradition values reason very, very highly, seeing in it the image of God in humankind. And they concluded that this amazing gift of reason must be given for a purpose. It was not to be squandered or neglected, but used appropriately in the service of the giver. And so they set out to understand God, themselves, and their worlds in rational terms. But there was one important caveat. Since certain aspects of God seemed beyond reason, and we can enumerate at least the Trinity, the Incarnation, and the Resurrection, tension and controversy did arise. From the 2nd century through the medieval period, and more urgently once the scholastic movement began in the 12th century, faithful Christians argued about how much of a role reason should be given. One thing became clear early on. Good theology could not be done purely with reason in the realm of pure abstraction and, we might say, logic chopping. Put in positive terms, this meant that reason and faith must be held together. To separate them was, quite literally, to court heresy, as the church fathers had insisted. So, a vignette, this is at the hinge point just before the beginning of the medieval period, which I take to be roughly, for the sake of argument, 500 to 1500. 451 AD, Chalcedon, Asia Minor. One of the very few councils that are still accepted as authoritative by all three major confessions of Christianity, formulated its famous four fences in a simple yet profound statement. The gathered group of teaching pastors, bishops, right? Because that's what bishops were. They were teaching pastors before they were ever functionaries in a hierarchy. They insisted that Christians are bound to speak of Jesus as, and I'll quote from the Chalcedonian document, one and the same Christ, Son, Lord, only begotten, to be acknowledged in two natures, and here we go, these are the four fences. He's in two natures, and those natures are without confusion, without change, without division, without separation. Those are the four fences of Chalcedon. Now, sidebar, you might wonder, why on earth are we actually even talking about this? These seem something rather fairly obscure and abstract. The reason was that people were teaching each of those four things as if they were true about Christ, and they were problematic. They run up against various issues with the canonical scriptural account. But what do these four fences do, these four withouts? They preserve the mystery of the relationship of Christ's human and divine nature. That was the question on the table. By those fences, the Chalcedonian pastors were claiming only that Scripture does not support those things, confusion, change, division, and separation between the two natures. Because, importantly, again, each one of those errors, through an over-rationalizing of the Scripture account in one direction or the other, was actually being taught by one party or another at the time. The pastors were not trying to define rationally the precise nature of the relationship between Christ's divine and his human natures. For that would have been to attempt to penetrate where Scripture revelation had not spoken. All right, so finally, so wrapping this up with a little bow. The Council of Chalcedon preserves a paradox that can't really be perceived or grasped entirely by reason. That a thing, Jesus, is 100% one thing, divine, and also 100% another thing, human, at the same time. That would be a problematic statement in the realms of the sciences or mathematics, and even logic. But harnessing reason in service of faith, those gathered pastors at Chalcedon specified only as far as they felt scriptural revelation allowed, and no further. All right, one more example. I actually put transubstantiation in the book as a different example, which you may want to look at, because that's a different kind of paradox about how something could be bread and wine and also Jesus at the same time. Figuring out what Jesus meant when he talked about this is my body and this is my blood. But I'm going to go now to atonement. All right, this is the central act of Jesus Christ on the cross, this atoning move. And the scholastic theologians apply reason to faith here too in the same cautious manner, as you'll see. They don't want to make too clear what God has made obscure, but to do our best to understand the things of God without doing violence to their sometimes very puzzling or paradoxical nature. So, Anselm of Canterbury, 1033 to 1109, some call him the father of scholastic theology. He wants to understand the bloody scandal that was the crucifixion. If you're a thoughtful Christian, or a thoughtful non-Christian testing the claims of Christian faith, you've likely wondered about this yourself. This is maybe even a harder nut to crack than the paradox of the two natures of Christ as human and divine. It may, in fact, be the greatest paradox imaginable. Because what the Bible teaches about the atonement for humanity, that the second person of the Trinity accomplished through dying at humans' hands, is not just incongruous. Why would an all-powerful God choose to redeem his human creatures in such a bloody and ignominious way? It's far worse than that, logically speaking. Because what the story of the crucifixion claims is this, that the divine being God, the only being who owns, so to speak, his own being eternally, he doesn't owe it to any parent or creator in time, enters the stream of time, lives within time, and then ceases, as all time-bound creatures do, to exist, at least on earth, as a creature. So this is just bizarre, all right? And Anselm, who is a very logical fellow and a thinker, presents his elegant argument in his still influential Cur Deus Homo, Why the God-Man. He starts with this same question. Why should we credit this story of the atonement, in which the eternal maker of all things undergoes a typically bloody and painful human birth, one assumes, in, again, a stable, lives a difficult, sporadically persecuted life, and finally allows himself to be subject to this extra legal proceeding and declared a criminal, nailed to a cross, and die? Couldn't God have achieved our redemption in a less implausible, not to say illogical, way? Anselm does not make the story rationally consistent by cutting off some part of the revelation. By doing, that is, the sort of thing that some early heretics had done in order to get rid of the tension between God's perfect divinity and his abject death. Anselm doesn't, for example, solve the conundrum by saying this. Well, God didn't really die because he never really had a human body. It was just an appearance. This is the solution that the early Docetists had moved forward. Or by saying, yes, somebody died, but it wasn't God. It was a very special man, Jesus, which is something like what became known as the Arian heresy. Instead, Anselm reasons from the structures of social understanding around him. He seeks in those cultural materials an understanding and an explanation that will satisfy his hearers without destroying the mystery. So here's the explanation he hits upon. God's honor, like that of a feudal king, has been offended and diminished by the original sin of his human subjects. And this terrible transgression must be addressed for that honor to be restored. While avoiding resolving the mystery towards Docetism or Arianism or other errors, Anselm retains it and explains it through the reasonable cultural metaphor of satisfaction. The king's honor must be satisfied, working out the mystery in an elegant and logical way so the people of his age could understand it. Anselm's explanations of the atonement don't do violence to the central mystery, which is, again, that the undying, fully divine God dies. The biblical paradox is not disposed of. Just as the Chalcedonian definition used reason to retain the paradox of the two natures of Christ, and I think transubstantiation retains the mysteries of the elements and Christ, Anselm has used reason to retain the scriptural paradox of the God-man who dies while asking how we can understand, at least in part, what God is doing through the atonement of Christ. So, wrapping up the first part then on faith and reason, what can we learn about how to approach Scripture from the examples of Chalcedon and Anselm? Of course, I would say, first of all, neither Chalcedon's statement on the two natures of Christ nor Anselm's on the atonement is the last word on the subject. For example, soon after Anselm came Peter Abelard with another but also scripturally based explanation of the atonement. That one took as its central metaphor not the correction of a slight to a feudal lord's honor, but the compassionate action of a grieving father willing to make the ultimate sacrifice for his wayward children, so they would be inspired in their hearts by the father's sacrifice and return to him. Something like the kind of story we get in Jesus' parable of the prodigal son. And when John Calvin, centuries later, returned to Anselm, he reworked some of Anselm's ideas for his own time in a penal substitutionary theory that seemed less feudal to him and more purely biblical, and is still hugely influential in 21st century Protestant preaching around the world. All right, what this suggests, again, is that every new generation and every new culture needs to do its own careful, sensitive work of reasoning with Scripture. While doing so, we could do much worse than follow the example of the scholastic exegetes, who themselves, following the example of the fathers at Chalcedon, set out to explore what may be explored with the wonderful gift of reason. I think of reason sometimes, in their view, as like a Stradivarius violin. It's this priceless thing that you've been given, and you need to figure out how to use it. You need to use it with passion and discipline. So they wanted to do that, but they insist on doing so within the irreducible mysteries presented in the pages of the Bible. All right. So, moving now to the second point. A second pair of things often torn apart today, love and logic. Here, Lewis, channeling the medieval tradition, is again, I think, an excellent guide. And this is true first of all because he experienced his own conversion to Christianity as unifying those two sides of himself, love and logic. You may remember this. As an adult, later on in his Christian life and his writing life, he came to regard his imaginative self as in some ways his most basic self. But as a young person, as a young officer in the First World War, he had decided that the Christian faith of his upbringing was intellectually untenable, and he had seen no way of bringing the imaginative side of his nature, which had experienced these moments of joy and yearning and mystery as he read stories and so forth, and really fed him with his rational side. His rational side told him that while stories might serve to amuse, they couldn't very well teach you about the things that really mattered in the world. So, famously, during a night conversation on the grounds of Magdalen College with Tolkien and another person as well, Tolkien shows Lewis how the two sides can be reconciled in the Gospel narratives. The Gospels had all the qualities of great human storytelling, but, Tolkien said to Lewis, they portrayed a true event. God, the storyteller, has entered into his own story in the flesh and brought a joyous conclusion from a tragic situation. If you've read Tolkien's essay on fairy stories. You know, he used the term eucatastrophe, a beautiful catastrophe. That's what the cross and the resurrection amounted to. And suddenly Lewis could find, it's like his eyes are open, and he sees that the nourishment he'd already received, even as a child, from the great myths and fantasy stories that he enjoyed, was actually a taste of the greatest and truest story, of the incarnation of the second person of the Trinity in the human person, Jesus Christ, and all that followed that momentous event. From that turning point insight, and from his medieval studies, Lewis came both to engage deeply, theologically and devotionally, with the incarnation, and to see in the incarnation a validation and elevation of our full humanity, as not only thinking, but also sensing, feeling, imaginative beings. While he saw that the exercise of reason brings us to propositional truth, he came to believe that only the exercise of the imagination, a path that engages us, yes, cognitively, but also affectively and sensuously, can bring us to the living meaning of who we are and who God is. So, at the center of Lewis's sympathy for the medieval way of seeing the world was a very particular understanding of how a person's hearts move them along a specific path to God. When he talks about both his own movement towards faith and the usual human process of conversion, you know this if you've read him, he speaks of this as a Platonic and Augustinian quest of desire. He uses that language. Lewis's apologetic argument that we experience a sort of lack or a hole in our inner selves, an unfulfilled desire that cannot be fulfilled by any ordinary worldly pleasure, and that this empirical fact indicates to us that there is a God who can and very much wants to fulfill that desire. This argument emerged, I think, from his own experience of his path to salvation. But, as an intellectual, as someone who read deeply in literature and history, as with all his experience, he applied to this one a strong set of philosophical and literary filters. None stronger than the Augustinian and Neoplatonic way of looking at the world that he found in, for example, a writer from the early 500s, a Roman official and philosopher named Boethius, whose allegory, The Consolation of Philosophy, became one of the most popular books of the Middle Ages. All right, anyone read The Consolation? Yeah? Oh, very nice. All right. It's worth reading. It's available in good English translations. You can probably just get on the internet and you find it, although I don't know if that would be the best translation. We see this medieval philosophical debt Lewis owed on the importance of desire on the very first page of his first autobiography. This is not Surprised by Joy, but The Pilgrim's Regress. And there are, at the very beginning, three quotations. The third one is from an Anglican theologian, but the first two are from Plato and Boethius. And together, those quotations make the same point about how people on the path to truth proceed through a kind of desire. And we see that the same debt to Boethius in the second is there in the second argument that Lewis built on the first. And I'm quoting now. Lewis argues that all creatures become more themselves, attain more happiness, and are more fully actualized the more they look to and act to God. That is, the more they exercise creaturely participation in divine attributes. You want to have more personality, you want to be more yourself, you need to find that in God. Boethius' character, Lady Philosophy, has similarly argued, drawing again from the Neoplatonists, that we can realize our proper nature only through union with the sum of all good and the source of all happiness. Again, God. God is then the true end of the desires that we pursue in partial and flawed ways through money, high office, fame, pleasure, and beauty. Lewis really wanted his modern hearers to understand these medieval truths and early truths that so powerfully united love and logic. But he found that modern Christians had largely abandoned the language of desire and love, that even the most cerebral of medieval thinkers, people like Anselm, we'll come back to that, and Abelard, had used as a matter of course when writing theology. His most memorable pushback against this modern problem came in his sermon, The Weight of Glory. If you asked, he said, 20 good men today what they thought the highest of the virtues, 19 of them would reply, unselfishness. But if you had asked almost any of the great Christians of old, he would have replied, love. You see what has happened? a negative term has been substituted for a positive, and this is of more than philological importance. Now, of course, Lewis does go on to say that the New Testament contains injunctions to take up our cross and follow him. It isn't all about desire and the fulfillment of desire. But he goes on to say that nearly every description of what we'll ultimately find if we do take up that cross contains an appeal again to desire. This is Lewis. If there lurks in most modern minds the notion that to desire our own good and earnestly to hope for the enjoyment of it is a bad thing, I submit that this notion has crept in from Kant and the Stoics and is no part of the Christian faith. Indeed, if we consider the unblushing promises of reward and the staggering natures of the rewards promised in the Gospels, it would seem that our Lord finds our desires not too strong, but too weak. You may remember how he concludes that passage memorably, and this really is just following Augustine, who was the most important and dominant theologian through the entire medieval period. Here's what he says. We are half-hearted creatures, fooling around with drink and sex and ambition when infinite joy is offered us, like an ignorant child who wants to go on making mud pies in a slum because he does not know what is meant by an offer of a holiday at the sea. So this affirmation of love sat in the medieval tradition, cheek by jowl with the most rigorous philosophical logic. Boethius was a philosopher and a translator of classical philosophers. And the person with whom I'm going to end this section is one we've already met as an exemplar of reason, the early scholastic theologian Anselm of Canterbury. And Anselm we have not a dried out academic theologian. I don't, by the way, believe that all academic theologians are dried out. But a man of powerful and deep devotion, and one who kept love at the heart of his logic. So Anselm's most read work was actually not Cur Deus Homo, that book about the Incarnation, or about the Atonement. Rather, it was his little book, Prayers and Meditations, which was designed to stir the hearts and infuse the prayers of his readers with love to God. This book's highly evocative, meditative, imaginative prayers focused on the lives and personalities of Christ and Mary and the saints. And they were designed for people to use in their private devotion. His stated purpose for publishing these was, quote, to inspire the reader's mind to the love and fear of God and to inflame the desire to pray. The reader's mind, note. These prayers were to be read slowly and meditatively, just as the scripture was read in the medieval monastic tradition of the Lectio Divina. And, though deeply devotional, this was no wildfire emotionalism. It was a unified approach to God that held together both affective experience and cognitive content in a single theological and devotional gesture. And that's quite typical of medieval mystics. They climbed to the experience of the divine on a kind of ladder of understanding. There is very often this kind of very structured doctrinal reality underneath those kinds of experiences. It was not a soupy kind of experience. Finally, it's worth noting here, as in so many other cases, the medieval church was merely echoing what had been passed down to it from the early church. While it is true that this kind of heart religion flourished and advanced all over Europe during especially the end of the High and the beginning of the late Middle Ages, Robert Louis Wilkin reminds us in a wonderful book, The Spirit of Early Christian Thought, that, quote, nothing is more characteristic of the Christian intellectual tradition from its very beginning than its fondness for the language of the heart. Even in the densest and most abstract theologizing of the early and medieval fathers, the goal was not only understanding, but love. Theory was not an end in itself. Concepts and abstractions were always put at a deeper service of immersion in the thing itself, the mystery of Christ, the practice of Christian life. So we can understand then why a modern author as deeply immersed in the early and medieval sources as Lewis was became so dedicated to reunite love and logic among the modern folk that it put them asunder. So the conclusion here in part two is that medievals kept love and logic together, which is to say that the religion was always most essentially a heart religion, even as it quested to understand the things of God. They assumed that while the mode of logic is an important and could get you a certain way along, nonetheless, relationality, emotion, devotion are constitutive of our faith. This is why God reaches to us in our inadequacy as people who will never see more than through a glass darkly, and inflame also our hearts with love for him. Christianity is not just an intellectual thing. Now finally we come to our third pair, the spiritual and the material. I will say about this is the one where I think we are most unlike our medieval forefathers and mothers. I'm going to look quickly again as they were treated both in Lewis and in the medieval period. And I want to jump right in with the delightful passage from the book we mentioned earlier, his magnum opus, English Literature of the 16th Century. This guy read every English work in the 16th century before he wrote this book, which is kind of crazy. And he probably remembered them all too, and could tell you what page things were on. Just really annoying. Medieval school children, said Lewis in this book, were taught farriery, forestry, archery, hawking, sewing, ditching, thatching, brewing, baking, weaving, and practical astronomy. And, he said, this concrete knowledge mixed with their law, rhetoric, theology, and mythology bred an outlook very different from our own. I touched on this earlier, now we're going to it in the quote. Here's what he said. High abstraction jostled the earthiest particulars. They talked more readily than we do about large universals such as death, change, fortune, friendship, salvation, but also about pigs, loaves, boots, and boats. The mind darted more easily to and fro between that mental heaven and earth. The cloud of middle generalizations hanging between the two was then much smaller. Hence, as it seems to us, both the naivety and the energy of their writing. They talk something like angels and something like stable boys or sailors, never like civil servants or writers of leading articles. In his discarded image, Lewis expands this observation, showing us that medieval saw the material world around them as tingling with anthropomorphic life, dancing, ceremonial, a festival, not a machine. Theirs, he said, was a world of built-in significance. Their cosmos was one of vibrancy and wonder. There's this great passage in Out of the Silent Planet where Lewis's protagonist, Ransom, looks out of the window of a spaceship that he's been shot up into space in, and he's expecting to see the black void of space that science has led him to believe should be there. And instead, he sees this pulsing, glowing kind of matrix of glory. This is how medieval saw their universe, as a place, as Lewis says, where each sphere is a conscious and intellectual being moved by the intellectual love of God, which I think is a nod to Dante. Does such mystical understanding of the cosmos reduce God to some sort of magician, meddling in material stuff to gain cheap effects among his human audience? Does it encourage rank superstition, which is a modern term for attributing to spiritual origins anything we still don't understand? That's certainly the understanding of many moderns. Now, Lewis reminds us ruefully, we live in an age of philosophical materialism in which everything is simply atoms. In this newer and poorer world, all the spiritual meaning that medievals had seen looking up into the night sky has vanished, leaving a Newtonian machine universe in its place. And this modern disenchantment of the material universe has separated the spiritual from the material. Even Christians today now miss the spiritual weightiness of both creation, God making all flesh, and incarnation, God becoming flesh. So for a moment now, as we begin to close, this is my first closing, so if you're counting, let's rewind the tape, so to speak, for just a moment, and see where this unifying of the spiritual and material emerges in Christian history. I'm relying here on historian Robert Marcus, who pinpoints the transformation at the hinge between the late, ancient, and medieval periods, right around 500 AD. Following the Christianization of the Roman Empire comes what Marcus calls the de-secularization of the world, or to put it on his head, the sacralization, the making sacred of the whole world. By the onset of the Middle Ages, Christians were looking at all things through eyes of faith. This was certainly true with one figure of that era, Gregory the Great, one of my all-time favorite Christian historical figures, the late 6th century monk, pope, and spiritual father of the Middle Ages, whose writings filled the cupboards of the monastic houses throughout the millennium that followed. Unlike his predecessor, Augustine, Gregory insisted that while people are engaged in the active life, working in the material and social world, everything in their experience becomes a potential instrument of God's direct and special communication to them. Chance meetings, storms, landscapes, crafted objects, a thousand other things. God is always speaking to us if we have but ears to hear and eyes to see. Gregory emphasized God's involvement with creation and the sacramental presence of spiritual truths in the things of this world. That's just the definition of sacrament, right? It's the material becomes a channel for the spiritual, which by its definition rejoins those two, the spiritual and the material. As Marcus argued, the sacramental sense of God at work in the material world and in our own embodied material, social, and cultural experience became part of the Orthodox Christian understanding of the world for the whole period from Gregory to the Reformation and beyond. This was not pantheism. God is not the tree. The tree is not God. It is an understanding that God's glory is reflected in creation and God's grace addresses us through ordinary things in creation. I would argue, and Lewis makes a similar argument in The Discarded Image, that we moderns need to begin taking seriously the scriptural stories of creation and incarnation as clues that the material world is not just a random collection of atoms. We scientific moderns who know better will have to allow the possibility that all this material stuff is first the handiwork of God, and second, still used by God to comfort, confront, discipline, and delight us. Further, we'll have to open ourselves to the truth that what we do with our stuff, our bodies, our families, our goods, economic work, neighborhoods, and food, among other things, does matter to God. In other words, Christianity is not merely a spiritual religion. Today, many say, I am spiritual, but I'm not religious, meaning something like, I have spiritual thoughts and feelings, but I don't have to act on them in an organized, physical, communal way in church or in concrete, ethical action in the world to know that I'm in touch with God. I said in an earlier draft, a medieval Christian would have laughed. I'm not even sure a medieval Christian would have understood that statement. We have perhaps not become, as some argue, body-denying Gnostics, although there's a family resemblance. I think we're far too fond of our creature comforts to actually condemn the material world as evil, as the Gnostics did. Rather, we just now assume that our material lives are spiritually neutral. That leaves us heedless of our body's significance as the one and only place in which we meet God. Because we think these things, sex, food, emotion, have to do only with biological matters of reproduction and sustenance, or with unfortunate physical tendencies that cloud our judgment or confuse our ability to see truth, and that they have no spiritual significance, we live our lives with God as a giant game of pretend. We pretend that the only part of us that matters is our spiritual part, whatever that is, really, I've never seen one. We pretend we can sustain a relationship with him by attending only to that part. We pretend that a vertical relationship with God is enough and that our horizontal relationships with spouses, children, parents, co-workers will simply sort themselves out if we spend enough time reaching out to God inside of our heads and hearts, as if alone is the only place God can be met. And because of all this, we cannot take seriously the power of disciplines such as celibacy, temporary or lifelong, fasting, brief or protracted, or stability within one community. Since the body is not a place where spirituality gets done, mortifying the body is not a part of our spirituality. Fasting is no gift to God. Keeping the heart for God by abstaining from sex is not an important spiritual discipline. Keeping fidelity to one community is no way to serve God because the social dimension lacks spiritual significance. God is a God for many of us of the spiritual things, but not the material things. He seems to have come in Jesus as a spiritual being, not truly a material, which is to say a fully human being. So the bodily realm ends up having no spiritual significance for us. Not evil, as the Gnostics held, just simply irrelevant. And I'm wrapping up here. I know you're looking at me. How are we doing here for time?
Have as much as you need.
Have as much as I need.
Need.
I have a broad definition of needs. Because, in fact, this is not true, that God is only the God of the spiritual and not the material, Rather, I would say it's devastatingly false. Then we can go through a series of sort of gloomy observations. Divorce rates are pretty much the same for Christians as non-Christians. We have no lower rate of obesity than do non-Christians. Perhaps worse is one study of Southern Baptists suggested, because eating is among some Christian cultures the only vice left that's allowable. We don't have another dessert. We don't make art worth looking at. We don't write poems worth reading. We don't build churches worth walking into or worshiping. And we don't give counsel to married people worth hearing. We may not even understand how to pass our faith on to our children, who are the fruit of our loins, to use the very earthy biblical image. On the other hand, we do not take seriously the ascetic disciplines that address our pressing, spiritually engaged bodies in ways that can turn them back to the Lord. And it should be said, we've also forgotten the art of dying well, ars moriendi, which was so well understood and lavishly explained in the late Middle Ages especially. Today our dying tends to take place in antiseptic spaces defined by technology and medicine, rather than signs of the great transition being undergone from the temporary but still important material reality to the eternal and thus ultimately important spiritual reality. If our bodily lives lack spiritual significance, then so too do our bodily deaths. And again, because we downgrade the horizontal relatedness in the quest for vertical relatedness, we find the ideas of mystical communion and fellowship with saints who have gone on before us both irrelevant and indeed irreverent. So much more can be said here. I'm sure we'll have a lively discussion. I hope so. But for now, a conclusion to this section, and then for the whole paper, and then a Q&A and discussion and more beer and whatever. Medievals kept the spiritual and the material together, which is to say, following the logic of the incarnation, that they affirmed the humanness of humanity. I remember when this light bulb kind of went on for me. What the incarnation does, meditating on it continually during the medieval period, especially the high and late medieval period, I think is to raise up not just for medievals the humanity of Christ, but also the humanity of humans. They assumed that being a Christian did not mean living on some spiritual plane, but rather discovering the spiritual truths that may come to us through, and in turn shape us in the ordinary lives of our bodies in the material world, of our communal nurture, of our social interactions, of our common human appetites and predilections and foibles. So to sum up now, finally, the 3 points. Once we recognize that our modern tendencies to separate faith and reason, love and logic, and the spiritual and the material are present and are something that maybe is not really true to our Christian tradition, one very helpful way back to the unity of these sundered things, though it is not the only way, is through the incarnational thought and practice of the Middle Ages. And if it seems too daunting to do this directly, there are in the works of C.S. Lewis, a professional medievalist, many clues and helps along the road. And of course, there are many fine present-day medievalists as well, some of whom can communicate quite well in popular prose and are accessible. And finally, you can do a lot worse than to go straight to Anselm or Dante or so many others, which are all available in fine English translations, and see whether the medieval synthesis doesn't open up to us another more holistic way of thinking and living. Thanks.
I want to thank you very much for your presentation.
Thank you, sir.
I think what you said was incredibly important. And I'm very grateful for you to emphasize the medieval synthesis, because that was so much part of my life for many, many years.
I wish it had been of mine until recently.
I
envy you that, but that's not a Christian virtue.
I'm not just a Christian, I'm a Catholic.
I think I'm being patted on the head a little bit.
Even worse, I'm an Irish Catholic from the north.
Even worse, sorry.
From the north, too.
Thank you for saying so. Yes, sir.
From your perspective, I mean, one of the realities in terms of the evangelical Christian position is that many evangelical Christians today totally reject the Trinity. They totally reject the Trinity as a misguided form of achieving Christianity. And in that, they also, it's one God, Jesus is God. That's all you need to know.
De facto. They may not have an articulate argument.
The point is that in that context, it's faith and faith alone. Faith and faith alone, that is your way to salvation. And I'm wondering, in the context of what you're saying, how you, as coming out of the evangelical tradition, address individuals who come to you and say, you're going down the wrong road, man. All you're doing is matter. In the sense of, you need faith, and you need to find your faith, and the medievalists don't matter.
Well, I mean, it's always helpful to meet someone on their own ground. I mean, the evangelical's own ground is the Bible, right?
Yes, and
one might point out that their Bible may only have two chapters, and that it should actually have four. And the two chapters that it has are the fall and the atonement, and the ones that they're missing are the creation and the new creation. And once they start actually reading the entire Bible, they might find that their perspectives are broken.
That's a good point. There's an Old Testament, forget about it, there's a New Testament, that's it.
But it's not, it's just the first few chapters and the last few chapters. Yeah. I mean, even that alone would really help.
Yeah.
I think, I don't know if I would agree that evangelicals as a rule deny the Trinity, but
no,
I think that there's a de facto,
there's
a crowd. And it may be just de facto in some, because they're only thinking about Jesus. They're not thinking about the Father or the Spirit. So. Thank you for that.
Not long ago, I had an atheist friend basically tell me that as a believer, I have no mystery. And that as an atheist, he has more mystery because of the unknown and everything. But when I started reading Lewis in college for the first time, and even Dante and how Dante organizes his inferno, and then Lewis borrows that in the space trilogy, that hideous strength out of the silent planet, all of a sudden I'm like, there's tons of mystery.
Yeah.
There's tons of excitement. And for me, it's that like you're saying, all these connections of the medieval with the spiritual, that really Lewis, to me, brought it back. And that excitement. The tough part is trying to communicate that, obviously, to someone who's used to believers just saying, well, this is what it is, and that's it. You have all the answers. And I'm like, no, there's a lot that's very mysterious. And so that's one thing, just as a comment, that I really appreciated from Lewis's writings.
One of the reasons it took so long for me to get to Lewis's nonfiction was certain people in campus ministry in Canada in the 80s who tried to argue me into the kingdom, holding some of Lewis's apologetic arguments in my hand. I thought, oh, that's what that's about. I'm not going to read that stuff. And a friend of mine said he had gone to a meeting of the Oxford C.S. Lewis Society, and after about 15, 20 minutes, he realized that there were actually two Lewises in the room. There was the evangelical Lewis, who supported certain arguments and so forth, and then there was the high church Lewis, the Lewis who began going to confession in 1940 and did so till the end of his life, who began to experience the real presence in the Eucharist, who began to venerate the cross on Good Friday and to take a sacramental view of marriage and so on. And I think evangelicals either don't know that Lewis or don't want to know that Lewis. And it may be that the imaginative Lewis that they love from the stories of their childhood bears more resemblance to that second Lewis than the first one. So I did have this sort of odd experience of coming to a different Lewis when I started reading his nonfiction later on. Yes, sir. He's going to correct me on Aquinas.
No. So you defined the Middle Ages as a whole millennium between 500 and 1500. So I'm interested in the latter part of that. What ended it? I suppose there's three candidates. There's modern philosophy. There's
You mean like nominalism or something after?
Well, Descartes these new way of looking at things. There's modern science, and there's the Protestant Reformation.
Which can't be that.
they all bear equal responsibility, or is there one where you would lay these problems at its door?
All right. So first of all, I would say I don't think it's modern science. At least not science as it was manifest in the scientific revolution in the 17th century. Because as I read that revolution, each of the sort of fathers of major disciplines and fields within science came to their work trying to think God's thoughts after him. They were Christians. And they were absolutely floored by the wonder of the world that God had created. And they were not just trying to dismiss God. You may know famously Isaac Newton, although he was no Orthodox Christian, he wrote more on the end times than he ever did even on science. So there was this, maybe a bad example, but there was still a lot of this sense of what I would call synthesis in those 17th century sort of parents of the scientific revolution. Now, if you want to put it later on and talk about sort of later uses of scientific materialism against Christianity, I suppose that's something that breaks down. Lewis says the thing doesn't actually all go finally to hell in a handbasket until after Jane Austen. So, I don't think as a Protestant he would have chosen the Reformation either, but he thought there was something that finally just sort of snaps towards the end of the 19th century. Perhaps, I suppose he would have said, with scientific materialism starting to roll up, but I don't know. I find that an impossible question. That's the kind of question a philosopher would ask to a historian to try to put him in a spot. I don't have one of those Jesus answers about, give credit to give to Caesar what is his due, and so I'll have to leave it at that. I actually think, though, I argue in the book that radical streams in the Reformation who I actually blame Ulrich Zwingli for a lot of things, all right? So Zwingli says, he makes a distinction between the internal and spiritual and the external and material, and he says, we will have nothing to do, the external and material has nothing to do with what we're doing as Christians. Tear down the art, break the sculptures, nail the organ shut. We're just about kind of pure internal truths. I think that was a horrendous mistake, and I think it's present in a lot of, at least, Free Church Protestantism today. So I blame Zwingli. How's that? Being a political season, I wanted to show you that I can actually give you an answer that addresses. Yeah.
I like what you said about the separation between materialism and spiritualism, and it kind of related to something I've been pondering lately, and I hope it's relevant enough.
Please, go ahead.
But I was wondering if you think the separation between materialism and spiritualism is causing a view on the environment and all the creatures in it that lacks the belief that they're also sacred and have a spiritual nature. And I'm wondering if you think that might be contributing to environmental destruction.
Yeah, absolutely. And, Tolkien and Lewis are both good on this. Tolkien is kind of an environmentalist itself, through the same kind of sacramental awareness of that unity of the material and the divine. I'm thinking of the lovely character in That Hideous Strength, Multitude the Bear, where Lewis actually gets inside the bear's mind and tries to interpret, what it's thinking and feeling. Maybe we should open ourselves to some of that. I have no doubt that these kinds of religious divisions are contributing to an abuse of the environment, and that one way back is through a re-exposure and awareness of the sacramental and of the kinds of things that I'm talking about. Basically, my book is going to solve all problems. I do have copies. Yes, I do have copies for sale. My publisher would be mad at me if I didn't say that. other questions or observations? Yeah, Robert.
I got a softball for you.
Oh, good. I love softballs.
All right. So, I grew up probably like many people here, reading the fiction of C.S. Lewis, Lobby of the Chronicles and Narnia. Lewis, the man, the author, the intellectual, give us your favorite C.S. Lewis anecdote.
Oh, my goodness.
And only one.
You said it was a softball. That had to be.
Mm.
The whole book, Surprised by Joy, is really kind of deep with me. I wrote a paper on it for an anthropology class as a non-Christian undergrad because I was so taken by it. And I'm thinking about the story that he tells where some of his friends, Barfield and a couple of others, start to follow the anthroposophy, this teachings of Rudolf Steiner and others. And he says, and at that point he was trying to do this new look, he was trying to be very rational, very kind of materialistic, and he said, here was all of that stuff that had horrified me when I was younger, this sort of, the spiritual, the occult, the reality of demons and all of this. And he says, why, damn it, it was medieval. And then he says, now I would never be taken in by this. And of course he's setting you up as a reader because not only is he taken in by this, the faith, the Christian faith at least, but he's, and the medieval period, but he eventually becomes, you know, the chair of medieval and Renaissance studies at Cambridge. So, now that's very highly crafted, and, you know, who knows whether the conversation, whether that happened is exactly as he stated it. That whole book is very highly constructed. I don't mean that he's falsifying, but I like the way that he tells the story, I guess. So that's one of my favorite moments. I'm imagining him here, you know. Oh, Barfield, how can you believe all this poppycock? And then, you know, then he makes the comment, this is Lewis, I think, a young atheist cannot be too careful of what he reads. And he goes off and he starts reading. He's reading MacDonald, he's reading. And then he starts to read, you know, Athanasius on the Incarnation. He read that very close to his conversion. He read Dante before he was converted. He went on holiday with, I think, actually Barfield. And they read, like, Plato in the morning and Dante in the afternoon, because that's what we all do when we go on holiday. And I know I do. But, so it was obviously getting into him even then. Yes, sir.
Earlier you mentioned how your experience of Protestant evangelicalism wasn't feeding the sacramental or incarnational view of the world that you were looking for. I'm kind of curious, in your opinion, where do you see a revival of the sacramental or incarnational view occurring in evangelicalism and the other traditions, Christian traditions?
In some elements of the emerging church movement, there's been a tendency to want to go to icons, to want to go to candles and things like that. It's still piecemeal. I mean, it's still not, it's not necessarily absorbing the... What I worry about is when you pull things out of the medieval smorgasbord and you don't have that kind of theological framework, for example, that the mystics themselves had. You're reading Penguin editions of the mystics and you're kind of feeling really good, but you don't really understand where that's coming from. Another place that I see it is in the 1978 book by Richard Foster, The Celebration of the Disciplines, which starts this sort of movement of attention to the spiritual disciplines and what he calls the spiritual disciplines, although they come from many, many different traditions. I still found that a bit piecemeal, but I had the pleasure of interviewing Foster and Dallas Willard, Eugene Peterson, and Jim Houston at Regent for an article several years ago. And Willard said at that point, the late Dallas Willard said, I think that one of the reasons this movement has stalled out is that in the seminaries, there is attention to spiritual formation, but it's over here. It's sort of over here in the corner. And the biblical studies department, theology department, and spiritual formation are sort of never the twain shall meet. And again, it's the same basic point. That's a problem. If you don't actually understand theologically what you're doing through things like the incarnation and sacramentality, then you're just trying things on. You're in the cafeteria, you're trying them on, but you're not necessarily, better not be my rental car out there. Well, maybe it was. So those are two places, I would say. Some younger modern Christians, I think in reaction to a kind of shopping mall / rock concert Christianity that just looks like everything else in the culture, are trying to find out a Christianity that looks more like something different, something that might contain truth, because they know that the surrounding culture doesn't contain truth. They've tried that, and that hasn't worked for them. And some of that has come in very embodied, very vivid forms, like icons and I argue in the book that it might be time to reassess the decision to have a plain cross rather than a crucifix in Protestant churches, because I think having the body of Christ present in worship is another way that we could recover this deeper incarnational sense of what's going on in the world. So, all right, that was a very piecemeal answer. But so things have happened, things are happening. But and then there's this sort of ancient future movement that Bob Weber sparked, the late Bob Weber from Wheaton College, which always goes back to the first 5 or 6 centuries of the church, but then gets really nervous about anything after that, because the medieval period is kind of where things start to go wonky, right? And I'm hoping through the book just to open a conversation, at least among evangelicals. Well, wait a minute, maybe there's some things that we could learn here. Anyway, I don't know if that really answered your question.
You gave me the idea that it's piecemeal, for sure.
It is piecemeal. I don't think there's... I would say there's no concerted... I don't think there's a concerted movement other than some evangelicals finally going, all right, I'm going Catholic or I'm going Orthodox because I can't find it within my own movement. I am told by professors in this area that there are, every year, increasing numbers of evangelical graduate students wanting to study patristics. And I think if they do that seriously, they will recover some of this more incarnational perspective, because it's in the patristic period, obviously, as well as in the medieval. Yes, sir?
I was fascinated by your discussion of the education process of children in medieval times, and just the all-encompassing
Lewis's
nature.
Description.
Yeah, Lewis's description. But the question I would have is, in the how many children went to school?
Yes.
Or how many children engaged in anything that would be considered outside of the family an education?
Right.
Well,
notice what he's saying is he's giving a long list of trades, essentially. And certainly children had that kind of apprenticeship knowledge passed on to them. What they knew or learned about friendship and love and salvation and death and all of those things, for most children, at least up until probably the 12th or 13th centuries, when you start to get the Franciscans and Dominicans and the monastics actually teaching local children, would have come more from oral tradition, would have come from something that their parents would have heard in a sermon or heard somebody else. The book by the English laywoman Marjorie Kemp in the late 1300s, she's illiterate, and yet she records having read to her over and over again books of devotion, scriptural passages, and so on. And she, in fact, well, it's her book. How could she write it? She's illiterate. She dictates it to some priests who are her friends. So I, yeah, that's right. You find ways. Yeah, and nobody can afford books anyway. So you do have to. I don't think we have any idea how powerful medieval memory techniques were, and oral culture in general. So this objection often comes up. Well, surely this was an illiterate society that didn't really know the things that you're talking about. Ultimately, we can't know. It's the nature of the historical record that it's kept on paper. But there seems to be evidences that there's a lively lay spirituality even among those who are illiterate. They're getting it from somewhere. Yeah. I hope that's helpful. One or two more, I'm told. So I'm happy to hang out the rest of the night, though. So if you want to on the chat first, you buy me a drink, I'll stay these long. One or two more. I want to make sure I'm not missing someone who's hiding out.
Well, if no one's going to ask one, I'll ask another one.
Moderator's privilege.
You mentioned something of the spiritual movement and sort of like the new age kind of phenomenon that's going on now. Do you think that is potentially a bit of a groundswell of this desire for something of a sacramental imagination going on? Is it perhaps a symptom of a deeper desire of man? That he's looking for something that actually satisfies both the spiritual and material sides, or perhaps I'm framing the question a bit too vaguely. I don't know.
I think that we find all kinds of replacements for God, and I am a jazz fan going way back, and all of my jazz heroes, you know, died of heroin overdoses, pretty much, like 90%. What I find in that is people who are spiritually attuned I think that music is a spiritual thing. I think these are people who are spiritually attuned, and they were desperately searching for something that would ground that and that would give them something that would be helpful for their living. But unfortunately, what they found was drugs. So I don't know if that answers your question or not, but it's what popped in my mind when you said it. In terms of the sort of I'm spiritual but not religious thing, I actually think that's moving away from a sacramental view. As I argue, I think that's saying I don't like the embodied forms of Christianity that I see. Lewis is very acute on this in the Screwtape Letters. He says, you go to an actual church, you sit there and you see actual Christians, it's like, oh great, this is the group I have to hang out with? I think I'll just go and be spiritual on my own, you know. So I think it does come from a yearning, but I think it's going in entirely and oppositely the wrong direction. So, yeah. Yes, sir.
Just wondering, thank you very much for your talk. I'm very grateful to hear what you say.
Thank you.
I'm very pleased to hear you talk about Tolkien, because to my mind, J.R.R. Tolkien was one of the most spiritual writers.
Absolutely,
of
I agree.
The 20th century.
I agree.
And people have not recognized that.
He said something about, I'm going to get the quote wrong, he said something in response to somebody's letter, that in the garments of flesh and character, of human incident, the realities of eternal life are present and are hidden. And I know that he saw his own writing that way after a certain point. He kind of, because he was a Catholic, he didn't intend to at first, but it just came out of him because that's who he was.
He was a great man, very spiritual man.
I agree. And the moral world is very compelling. And I know of people who were converted to Christianity because Tolkien's work became a bridge for them. They discerned those things in Tolkien, which is remarkable.
I was working at a bank when I first read him. And after that, I just thought, this is just marvelous. He's just so special.
Yeah, you see that in him. Thank you so much, folks. Thank you for your comments.